read out what everyone's given here. Just kidding. Don't forget your quarter. Quarter million? Quarter dollar? Jesus. I can't tell you how much I believe prayer works. And God hears us. You know, He even hears the stuff you don't say. Did you know that? Like, even the prayers that are in your heart. You know, it's good to pray aloud, but sometimes sometimes we're too broken to even pray aloud, to pray in our heart, and He hears that too. This thing you heard Hannah in the OT, Samuel, Jesus. Very quickly, I want to just mention my God heard my grandmother's prayers for me when I was totally lost, didn't believe in God, didn't believe in, just totally lost. And God got a hold of my life supernaturally. So there's been a number of times where the Lord's challenged me to sow $1,000. And that was a big, for me, it's like, $1,000, it's a lot of money, right? And then a number of times I've been like, Mark, I phone up Mark and I'm like, I feel God saying to do this. He's like, yeah, awesome. And I'm like, oh. I kind of wanted him to say, you know, I feel caution on it. Like, a little bit. Just like, can I sleep on it? Because oftentimes, like, I feel this thing and it's just like, and God's like, I'm like, okay, when is it now? I'm like, how? He's like, e-transfer, just do it. You know? And so about a year ago, actually, I felt the Lord say, I want you to sow $1,000 into Faith Team. And just give it to her personally. And I'm like, you guys know Faith Team, Crisco?
Yeah.
Faith Team, Graf, can't bring that much listening. Now that she's married. But I didn't want it, really. And I told my wife, and she's like, I don't think so. So I actually did sleep on it, and then the next day it just got, you know, when it just, when God's talking to you, and it just got stronger. And so I e-transferred her, and I'm like, hey, Fatine, just really felt to sow this into your life, and da-da-da-da-da. And she, late that night, she emails me back, she goes, thanks, Jason. Really appreciate your seed. God bless you. Like, that's it. I'm like, oh, Jason. Like, at least I wanted, like, you know, her to come up, shake my hand. $1,000. You know, and we gave out of our abundance, and you know, didn't hurt us too bad, but it's you know, still a lot. Well, we just my wife and I, we've been asking the Lord for the right house for a while. And so my testimony, got a couple, but we actually just purchased a house. So we got a house that's 280 Ross Street. And I was thinking, drive by and just bless it. We're going to have a Holy Ghost party in there as soon as we get back from Florida there. We're going to have a Holy Ghost party. We get possession on March 15th while we're away on vacation. So Carly's dad's going to... Yeah, and so it's pretty cool. It's a pretty cool house, and we got it for a fair deal. It's so, but about 2 months ago, I won't say who it is, but I had someone come and just sow a seed for $3,000 into us, and just say bless you, and we want to see you get a house. Wow. And it's not like we're like lacking, you know. God is just, it's the overflow. Mm-hmm. And then this week, the same people came up and said, we'd really like to sow $10,000 into you for a house, towards your house.
Wow.
And I started crying. I'm just like, just blown away, you know? And pretty cool stuff, eh, Will? When you just, you know, you just sow and you're faithful to God. And I can't tell you how much, like, God wants to prosper you. And He wants to bless you. And it's more than just tithing and giving. You got to be, you know, it's a funny story. We moved a couch this week, and there's friends of friends or family of friends. And they said, can you move this couch for us from Corona to Sarnia? I said, okay, $100 cash. I'll just do it for you. And it's, you know, should be 150 really. It's a big, stupid, big couch. Brand new, white leather. Like just, probably a $5,000 couch, right? Something like that. We're like, we'll do it. So we went to Corona, we picked up the couch, and we're dropping it off in Sarnia, and I look at this doorway that this thing's supposed to go in. And I'm sitting there, I'm like, you know, Dave? I'm like, no. One of those doorways where it's like you walk in, there's a closet right there, so you gotta turn, so you gotta actually stand the couch up and then bottom it out. And I'm like, no, this thing, it's not going. And the people are like, well, we wanna try. Because they had just got rid of all their furniture to get this couch in, and they bought this couch and stuff, right? So I'm like, I wouldn't recommend it, and I told them I'm not liable if something happens. And then my buddy, my partner there, Ray, who I'm trying to get to church, total heathen, like, this guy's a sinner. He needs Jesus. He knows it. He knows it. I tell him all the time, you know? I'm very real like that with my friends and people, like, just like, But anyway, he said, Josh, we're going to about to pick it up to try. And he goes, Josh, say a prayer right now, will you? He's never said, say a prayer. Like, ever. And he said, say a prayer, will you? So I prayed. I said, Jesus, just thank you that you favor with this couch and pray that we get it in and it wouldn't rip. You know, because ripping couches isn't that. We don't rip couches because I don't do stupid stuff like try and get it in places that's not going to fit. And so we get it, like we had a couple guys helping us from the owners that were getting the couch. So we lifted it up and we're like, we have blankets everywhere. We're being as safe as we can, shrink wrap the couch, try to get the squishy part a little bit in, you know what I mean? And then we're trying to get it in and this thing's not going to go. It's just not happening. And the guy's like, well, just push, just try a little bit. And so we're like, all right, so we just tried a bit more. Couch rips. and the guy's like, his wife's not there yet, right? She's still at work, and she has her couch and her little baby and stuff. So the husband's just like, this look of mortification comes on, mortified look comes on his face. He's like, my wife's going to kill me. I'm like, you told me that, so we're not liable. So I got him $100, and we're driving off. And I'm thinking, God, what's up with that? And the Lord spoke to my heart and he said, son, wisdom does not, or he said, son, praying does not supersede wisdom. You know, just because you pray doesn't mean that it's going to happen if it's not wisdom. Do you know what I mean? So all that to say, God calls us to be wise with our money. But he also calls us to be strategically generous with our money. So I don't just take my money and go and just do whatever with it. Very intentional. I want to be very intentional with every dollar. Amen? I want to be very intentional. So we got that $10,000 blessing. And as is our custom, what we do with every dollar that God gives us, we give 20% back into the church. Every dollar that God gives, doesn't matter where it comes from, it's a gift. If I earn it, if someone gives me $10, two of it goes back. This is what we do. This is my heart. Now, God said, in his word says, give 10%. But that's what we just do. That's what we've been doing. And we also bless our pastors with 2%. So $200 will go to an extra, right? And then we're going to put $7,800 right against our mortgage. And that's just what we do. That's what we do. And it's what we're going to keep doing. My prayer, Willis, I'm serious. I'm like, can I get to the place where I'm just like, I'm so like in this kingdom thing where I'm just like 50% or more is just back to the kingdom of God. My life is just the kingdom of God. And I'm not even worrying about any finances or anything because I'm just in the kingdom of God and his flow. And I'm partnering with heaven and I'm partnering with the kingdom. And this stuff is real. I mean, you read the Bible, you read what Jesus says about money. He is very, like, he doesn't want you to be broke. Yeah. Whew, come on. You got to just help me here for a second. You guys are looking at me like, he doesn't want you to be broke. If you just read your Bible, like New Testament, Jesus talks a lot about money. And he wants people to be faithful stewards of their money. Amen. Amen. So I'm just getting my money preach out from last week because I didn't get, I got cut short by a berry. Cut short by a berry. You ever got cut short by a berry, Sam? All the time. Just kidding. I'm just kidding. Okay. Can you guys receive that this morning, at least?
Amen.
Like, God wants to bless your finances. Oh, the other thing we did was I told you about that, but I gave away my car. Mm-hmm. You know, $3,000 car, just give it away. And I'm just like, I'm thinking about Michelle, and I'm like, maybe I'll go in there and drop a big tip. Like, and when I say big tip, maybe I'll just drop $500 or something like that as a tip and just bless. You know, maybe not. We'll see. I'm thinking about it because I'm just like, Jesus, I just want to be, you're blessing me and I just want to give. And so when God gives to you, give back to Him. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So, and begin to learn and ask God for a revelation on tithing and giving and prosperity. He'll give it to you, man. He'll give it to you. He will prosper you. Amen?
Amen.
All right. If you're mad at me, that just means, if you're sitting here and you're like, I'm always talking about money and you're talking about money, that means that you need to start giving. Because you've got a poverty mentality and God is challenging it. Right? You've got a mentality that is keeping you poor. Maybe you even have money, but you're poor in spirit. There's a lot of people who have a lot of money, and they keep it to themselves and stuff, but they're poor when it comes to the grace of God. They're poor when it comes to to spirituality. They're poor when it comes to their relationship with Jesus. So that even if you have money, you can have money and be poor.
Right.
You guys know that? And you could have like not a lot of money and be rich because you're faithful, like Jesus. Okay, so the Lord dropped a word in my heart, and we are very thankful for all the children's ministry that's going on right now. We've got like 8 babies opening. I don't know how many babies we got. How many? 8? I don't know, maybe there's not too many now.
There's not that many.
We got babies over there. We got about 7-8 kids over there with 2-3 helpers, and it's awesome. And if you have a passion for kids and you want to get involved with children's ministry, you should talk to Frankie or talk to Andrea, and you should get involved. Also, we need greeters. Like, who here would think it would be awesome to come to church and there's like a boombox, or not a boombox, but like a stereo, like one of those just like chilling with and just blasting worship music, mm-hmm. like this spring and summer, just out into the streets, like just set up a little thing and just be blasting and be evangelizing people as they walk by and, you know, that kind of stuff. Like, who here wants to, like, get involved, become a greeter, do something, like, get involved. Amen? All we can say is you can just try. So I felt like the Lord spoke to my heart, and we're going to have Todd Bentley come back.
Yay!
I believe in April. Is that what we're thinking? Mark is gone, but I think we're thinking April or May, but I'm thinking April. I'm hoping April. And I was thinking about Todd coming back, and I really felt like the Lord already gave me a word to share about the purpose, like to share with everybody who comes to the meetings. Probably going to do about 3 nights with Todd as opposed to one for last awesome. I just did 1 night. But I really felt like he just laid a vision for the whole meeting, like the little mini conference or nightly meetings that we're doing. And it's not, here's what it's not for. We're not bringing Todd just to give you a spiritual boost.
Yeah.
Although that could happen. Right? We're not bringing Todd in just to, because, well, Todd Bentley and this and that, and have a little meeting. We're not bringing him in just for hype. We're bringing him in for this reason, so that you would be equipped. Everyone say equipped.
Equipped.
Equipped to make disciples. Equipped to be a disciple of Jesus, but equipped to make disciples. And I'm just thinking about, you know, all the things that we've faced in the last decade of ministry. And the thing about when you say, make disciples, and everyone's like, you're sitting there and you're like, but I'm so broken, and I'm so screwed up, and, you know, so much of the church is just like, we're not even there yet, but God's like, part of your process of being healed is healing others.
Amen. Yeah, amen.
Like, you don't have to wait for some magical moment where you feel like you have everything together before you can start reaching out to people.
Come on.
Right? Before you can start being Jesus' hands and feet.
Mm-hmm.
Like, obviously, if you're in like some gross sin and like you need to get out, like get out of it and get on encounter and get deliverance and do whatever you need to do, like get healed up. But like you're not gonna ever feel ready, 100%. You know what I mean? You're not gonna feel like now is the time I should launch a cell group. Like it's scary. Just like I encourage people to evangelize and to share their faith. And when you first, like I stress if because a lot of people never push past the fear of man to actually share Christ with somebody. But if you do and when you do, you're not going to feel like, you know, necessarily bold as a lion to just go do this. You just got to start, you got to push. Like following Jesus, following the voice of God oftentimes is a push. It is, it stretches you, right? Evan Roberts prayed in the Great Welsh Revival. He said, Lord, bend me. Lord, bend me. Lord, bend me. Just bend me. So I'm in the farmer's market with Davina yesterday. And I've got a few minutes. I got to go to work and we're getting donuts. Like Saturday morning, breakfast, donuts at the farmer's market. Davina, what you want to go to the farmer's market? Yeah. Oh, What do you want to do? Get donuts. That's what she wants to get, donuts. And so we're going to get donuts, and I stopped by the little coffee guy. I like that little cop, Josh. Something I'm trying to get him to church too. But this guy walks up beside us, and he has these like really thick glasses, and he's like, he's an older guy, and he's like, I'm trying to get this special blend, and he's like, but I can't see anything. That's what he said. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like he's like blind. And so my heart starts beating because I'm like, I gotta pray for this guy right now, right? And so I'm like, I just turned to him, I said, sir, I'm like, you can't see anything? Because I'm about to like lay hands on his eyes, like I'm just about to like just go, I want to just put my hands right in the middle, 100 people around, this guy's eyes are about to get open, like that's what I'm thinking, like, let's just go for it, right? Story of my life is what we do every day. It's what I do every day. Or I try to. He goes, no, I can see fine. These are motorcycle glasses. Just like, got all stirred up for nothing because he meant something different. But I'm like, this is what we need. This is what we need to be doing, right? This is what we need to be about. Like this is our. I was thinking also about. I was meditating and just thinking, God, like, you called this church Dunamis, and it sometimes bugs me. Because it's so different. And I'm just like, can't we be like Hillsong, like Elevation, it's like something, you know, like, just like, I don't know, Grace Church or something like, what's Dunamis? And God's like, this is what I'm calling you to be. What is Dunamis?
Power.
So I'm calling your church to be in the house of miracles. I'm calling your church to press in to the unlimited power of God. And so I felt like the Lord speaking to my heart saying, unlimited power. And just this word, unlimited power, because he hasn't put a cap on his grace. He hasn't put a cap on his power. You can be as fruitful as you want to be in this life. God's not holding you back. Right? Which may not be true because there's instances where he does hold you back. Because if you're not like listening and being teachable and moldable, then he'll just put his hand on your head and just hold you back until you're ready to be teachable and moldable, because he's not going to give you an anointing if you're bullheaded and stubborn, right? You guys get me? His anointing comes, it flows through humility. Right? So you guys are here right now. I'm being humble. You might think like, oh, Josh is so arrogant. He's just like, whatever. Actually, I tell you, it's just the opposite. I'm like down here just going, God, like, how do I serve these people? How do I serve the people on YouTube? How do I serve my city? How do I serve people into a greater relationship with Jesus, and out of that, a greater expression of his kingdom and of making disciples and of doing what people are called to do? So when we have, Mark, you didn't hear, but when we have Todd Bentley, the Lord gave me a word. The purpose of having Todd Bentley is to stir up the church not just for evangelism, but to actually like make disciples. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know, Will, you know, I don't want to focus on you so much, brother. Rip my shirt. You know that 99%, 98, 99, whatever, give or take a percent, of the church in Sarnia, like we're talking about like all the churches, there's probably 10,000 Christians in the city that go to church. I don't know how many go to church, probably 10,000 or less. I don't know exactly how many, but most of them, like they're not doing the ministry of Jesus. Like the Great Commission in Matthew 28, Jesus said to his church, go out and make disciples. Go out and preach the gospel to all men and make disciples of all nations. And so like God wants this city, the whole city, every drug addict, like you see drug addicts, I see apostles. Like it's just like I'm so thankful. We've seen some fruit and it's been good. Like I'm so thankful for Kyle, like 20 years, full blown drug addict. And now God is sending him with an apostolic mission and he knows it. And he's a bit arrogant about it, but I'm like, you know, I'm like, well, thank God for school of ministry, because God's going to take the sandpaper to him and prepare him. Yeah. Because I'm like, dude, shut up about your calling. I know that you're called. Like, sorry, Kyle. Just go for it, man. But I mean, you'd probably be mad if I did.
He's watching.
You know he's watching. He might be watching.
He's watching.
Oh, he's watching.
We love him.
But that's what God did to me when I went to school of ministry. He took the sandpaper of his love to my, you know, to all these rough edges. And he's still doing it. I still get the sandpaper sometimes. Who loves the sandpaper? You are crazy if you love the sandpaper. Nobody loves the sandpaper. Nobody loves the sandpaper.
It's okay.
But, so, I feel like the Holy Spirit is encouraging us this morning. He's saying, listen, church, there's actually no limit. Michelle, there's no limit. Like, you want to have an anointing on you? You want it to truly be the overflow cafe where signs, wonders, and miracles happen through a restaurant and business? Like, okay, that can happen.
Yes, it can.
But it might cost you something. It actually will cost you. Might cost you everything. There's no limit to what God can do. There's no limit to what God can do in and through you. Amen. Can we just go for a minute to Ephesians chapter 3? Bible.
First one.
Ephesians 3. Let me get there and then I'll tell you what verse. Stuff's gotta look and see what looks good. Hallelujah. Let's go to verse 7. Verse 7. Paul is writing this letter to the Ephesians. Ephesus had a strong church. Some scholars believe the church was anywhere from like 10,000 to 100,000. Timothy was pastoring it at one point when he wrote to Tim. Anyway, huge church, big church, powerful church. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace. Everyone say gift.
Yeah.
Okay? So God's grace is a gift. Amen? He saves you by himself, by his grace. He saves you by himself. It's his grace that comes to you. And you have no ownership over your salvation other than you just received it. You made a decision and you said, I decide to receive this thing called grace. And even that decision that you made, that's not even you, because it's God's grace that gave you the grace to make that decision in the first place. So it's grace through and through. Mm-hmm. Amen? Like you're sitting here and if you know Jesus, it's just, it's his grace that has brought you in. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. So, grace is given not to hoard it in and keep it for yourself, but to give it away,
yeah, right.
To preach it, to share it. And I would like to propose today that if you want an increase of God's grace and His anointing on your life, you've got to give away what He's given you now. Does that make sense? You've got to give it away. Even if you just have, you're like, I don't have much. I just have this little bit.
Give it away.
Well, give it away. You have a Facebook account? I just encourage the whole church, every person watching me, do not post your drama on Facebook.
Amen.
Don't, like, it serves no purpose. Keep your drama to yourself, because drama on Facebook just multiplies your drama.
That's for sure.
And instead of growing in Jesus Christ, you're growing in drama. And eventually that drama has the potential to take you out, at least, or take you out for a season.
That's right.
And I know it feels good when your drama is multiplied, because then you don't have to focus on your heart and on what's really going on, because now you can just focus on all the drama. You guys chalking with me?
Mm-hmm.
That's why people post drama on Facebook or any other social media, because they're like, pay attention to me so I don't have to deal with my own issues and my own heart. Amen?
Amen.
Don't post drama. Post what Jesus, post the goodness of God, post encouragement.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Post about Jesus. I encourage everybody, when you go home today and you get on Facebook, which is like what a lot of you do, addicts. Get on Facebook, say, church was amazing this morning. Even if you didn't think it was, just prophesy. Church was awesome. You need to get, or Jesus just met, I just met with Jesus today, and He just, you know, post good stuff. Anyway. To me, that was a little side note. To me, though, I'm the very least of the saints, this grace was given to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery for ages in God who created all things. So that through the church, everyone say through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to rulers and authorities in heavenly places. Okay, this is like so massive. The calling of God on the church is actually to demonstrate the manifold wisdom of God even to the demonic realms and to the angels. There is coming an authority on the church of Jesus Christ that we will be so powerful, everyone say powerful, that the whole spiritual realm will be amazed at what is happening through the church of Jesus Christ. Whew. That's a good word right there. This is what God's wanting to do. He's looking for people to press into this reality. Because God wants a city. He wants our whole city. So we could go on rabbit trails here, but let's... Verse 11. This is according to the eternal purpose that He has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in Him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering, which is your glory. For this reason. Why? What reason? The reason He just said that the church is going to demonstrate the manifold wisdom of God to rulers and authorities and principalities and powers. I bow my knee before the Father. Bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in your inner being. Isn't that awesome? You know what that word strengthened is in the Greek? It's the Greek word endunamu. I like that. Endunamu. Sounds like it reminds you of a cow. In dunamu. Like, get the power of God on the inside of mu, of you. Get the power of God on the inside of you. The strength of God. You know what I sing to my daughter when I sing to her at night? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. We are strong because he is strong. Yes, gee. And my wife called me on it. She goes, that's not the song. This is we're weak. And I said, well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says we're strong because he is strong.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says we're powerful because he is powerful.
Amen.
Jesus Christ lives in you. Amen. How can you be weak when the King of Glory is on the inside of you? How can you complain about this and that and these situations when you have access to the manifold wisdom of God in your hands 24 hours a day, plus Holy Spirit reminds you of stuff? You don't even just have black and white letters, you've got the Holy Ghost and the Word to give you wisdom for any situation. Wisdom. With that couch, not gonna go in there. No matter how much we pray. Unless God supernaturally shrunk the couch and then made it big again or something like that, but wisdom. Because when you start to couple wisdom with prayer, with pressing in, with perseverance, with knowledge, you begin to, like, fruit just begins to multiply in your life. Disciples begin to come from you. Amen?
Yeah.
I'm just like, when I lay in my bed, was laying in bed this morning, and God's like, what do you see? I just saw this little room just filled with like 200 people. And God's like, yeah, that's what I want to do. But it's not going to be just you. It's going to be the whole church. Rest pulling people, just going for it. You know?
Yeah.
Like, I'm okay with you. Mark had a testimony. He shared a prayer the other day with this guy got dragged to a Promise Keepers conference. Like, kicking and screaming. This guy was like, he didn't want to go. But someone dragged him to go. And the first night, he gets saved. And then that night, he goes back to his wife and confesses all of his sin to his wife. And he gets totally saved. And his life now, Mark, is totally transformed by the glory of God. Because someone said, you gotta come to church with me. Come on. That's what I'm doing. Like, it's okay. But you are still screwed up. Yeah, but Jesus is working on me. The power of God's on the inside of me.
Well, you're not perfect yet.
Yeah, but Jesus is. He's perfect. Well, I don't like the way Josh preaches. Well, don't worry about that. It's not about that. It's all about Jesus. Jesus is perfect theology. Right?
Amen.
Like, what do you believe? Jesus.
Amen.
Okay. In Dunamu, with power through his Spirit in your inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love, next verse, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. I mean, this is good stuff, man. That you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That you may be filled with all the fullness of God. You might be like, well, I don't know if I'm filled with the fullness. You ain't filled with the fullness if you don't know it. Trust me, you begin to touch God in his fullness and begin just to experience him. You know, one of the reasons I like church is because together, I believe together we can touch something that we can't touch alone. There's something about corporate when we're all just reaching for God and we're all pushing into, we're all saying, God, come and meet with us. There can be a corporate anointing. That is just like a well, that we're here together pressing into God, and it just gets deeper and the river gets stronger, because this thing is tangible, man. This thing is real. God's presence, God's glory, his river is real. Amen? It's tangible. We're not just doing something. Like, this is God. God. Fullness of God. Verse 20. Now to him, everyone say him.
Amen. Amen.
who is able, say able.
Able.
Him who is able to do far abundantly above all that we ask or think. I know you've heard this verse before, but just hear it like you've never heard it before. Okay? Just like, okay, look at me for a sec, look this way. Okay, you've never heard this before, and I'm just about to tell you, you have no religious lens to look through. Okay, just go like this. Everyone go like this. Just take off your religious glasses. Okay, you've never heard it before. Take those, okay, good. Now to him, God, who is able, totally able, all things are possible with God, to do, everyone say do.
Do.
Okay, he doesn't just love you, he wants to do for you. What? I don't know what you need. What do you need? Mark, what are you asking for, man? Let me encourage your heart. Spirit of God, Mark, actually, the Spirit of God just pointed that out. He's encouraging your heart today. Because you pulled me some big stuff. And God's saying, don't you dare give up on the stuff that I've told you. Because to him who is able to do abundantly, more abundantly than all we ask or think.
Come on.
Glory.
The Amplified pipes in and says, or imagine, according to the power at work within us. According to the power at work within us. Isn't that awesome?
Yep.
You sound a little...
Yeah.
So the caveat is, I gotta be done. We gotta do communion. The caveat is, God's power is available. Far more than you can ask or think or imagine. But it's according to the power that's working in you. So the question that begs is, how do we get the power of God to work in us? You guys want to know?
Yeah.
Come back next week. You can begin to push into it. I'll give you a hint. To be continued. Yeah, everything. This is life, right? We don't just do church together, we do life together. Right? If you're really hungry, Facebook message me and ask me. Maybe I'll write you something. Or just read the Bible and start to ask Jesus, how do I get, I mean, if you're going to write something down, write this down. How do I get the power of God working in me? I'm figuring this out right now. I got some stuff to share. There's more. I mean, one thing I do is I pray in tongues. This is like a controversial issue in the church still to this day.
Oh, I don't know about the tongues.
You just gotta, like, just read your Bible, like, for, like, 10 seconds in the book of Acts or, like, anywhere in the New Testament, and you'll find out pretty quick, like, this thing called tongues and prophecy and miracles and healing and all the gifts of the Holy Spirit, it's all real.
That's right.
And it's supernatural. So when I go, I can just speak, even just those 5 words, I can begin to feel the power of God just working in me.
Amen.
Earlier this week, we did a move on Monday, and the lady there, she was a total heathen. And, well, I don't know, I'm just kidding. She wasn't, she didn't know, I don't think she knew Jesus. Maybe she had some church background or something, but I didn't know. We all know. On her car, she had like the zombie apocalypse. A-team, whatever that thing is, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Zombie. Huh? Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, I was doing the bill and she paid me and I go, and her parents were there and I'm like, somebody has back pain right now. Is this a word of knowledge? It was simple. She's like, I do. And I'm like, how long have you had back pain? She said, 6 years. I said, stand up, I'm gonna pray for you right now. She goes, what? and I took her arm and I said, stand up. So I will pray for you right now. God's gonna touch you. Like I didn't give her the option.
Yeah.
I just say, like that's what I do now. I'm just like, people that need a touch from God, I just go, I gotta pray for you. Jesus is gonna touch you. Because you know what I learned? If I'm touching them, Jesus is touching them.
Yeah. Wow. Amen.
Yeah. Ooh.
Because he lives in me.
Yeah. Receive that.
Yeah.
So I don't have to be like, oh, can I say a prayer for you for healing? That's not biblical. Yeah. I don't say prayers for healing. I just heal in the name of Jesus. Right. He's the healer. Yeah. People are like, oh, you can heal. I'm like, no, I can't heal a fly. But Jesus can do anything.
Right.
So I just said, in the name of Jesus, let this back be totally healed. Lord, touch this back. Blah, 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 whatever I prayed. And I go, check it out. And she goes, oh, it still feels the same. I said, sit down on the chair. Prayed for her legs to grow out. Grew out a little bit. Just because that's all I need, about 16th of an inch. She stood up and says, it feels about 30% better. I'm like, praise the Lord. And I just felt release. And then I left. And the guy, her boyfriend, messaged me on Facebook and said, thank you for praying for her. Her back has been feeling good all day. Yeah. Praise the Lord. She was telling me. Praise the Lord. You know what that is? That's just a seed.
Yeah.
That's a real seed.
That's a seed.
Mm-hmm. Maybe 20. And it just multiplies. Like, this is what God's calling us to do. Bring it. So this is what the Holy Spirit spoke to me. I know we're going a little over time on this. I had to get some stuff out, and it's just throwing out stakes.
Yeah, you are.
Sometimes we pass around the milk, and sometimes we're like, who wants? Some of you guys are like, ah, nah, nah. Some of you guys are like, that steak looks a little bit too much for me right now. The Holy Spirit spoke to me a few months ago and said, son, this year, and I don't know if it's every year, but this year, he said, January to March will be a season of prayer and intercession in your church. April, May, and June will be a season of evangelism. And so, and just even yesterday, I was going to the farmer's market, man, I just felt so stirred up, I felt so convicted in my heart. And I'm like, God, what's up? I just want to preach to everyone. He's like, the season is coming. Like, I'm calling this church to reach people, to bring people to Jesus. Like, and it looks messy sometimes. Bring your kids to Jesus. Tell your kids, listen, you need to come to Jesus. Like, just be bold about it. Just be bold. Also, you be loving. You know what I mean? And Holy Spirit will lead you. And the really cool thing is, like, you don't have to tell me. You're like, Josh, that's scary. And it pushes me. And it's uncomfortable. And I don't like it. And I don't think you should be telling me to do things that I don't like. Like, give my money. Give my money. And preach to people when I'm still totally screwed up. But listen. I've been so discouraged, I tell you the truth, I just want to say in time, Jesus, rewind that time a bit. I've been totally, totally depressed and just like, God, where are you? And he just says, go to the mall, share Jesus with me. And I'm like, God, I'm depressed, I just told you, like, I feel depressed. And then I go, and I start to talk to people, and two things happen. One, the Spirit of God starts working, and two, I'm like, wow, there's a whole lot of people that are way more screwed up than me. And this is awesome. And so I'm doubly encouraged, because Holy Spirit's encouraged me, and I'm like, wow, there's people out there that are just, they're in the dumps of life, and at least I'm, like, better than them, and it's not a very good thing. But I'm just kidding. I'm not better. You know what I mean? I'm, like, I'm healthier, and God says, yeah, keep going. Because there's people out there that are waiting for your touch. Okay, the light of God and the anointing of God, it works in the darkness. Yeah, you get into the darkness and you begin to bring. One of my spiritual fathers, Dan Chapel, he went into a like a a gay bar thing, like not a gay bar, but like a nightclub. It was like transvestites and all these women, men dressed in women and all this stuff, right? There's this young kid, this boy, 17, 18 years old, and he's dressed as a girl, has a dress on and makeup, and Dan just starts talking to him, just like a friend. And the presence of God just shows up in this place. And God, and yeah, this Dan, my friend Danny's a prophet. He said, "Lord, you're here. You're in this place. You're here." And the Holy Spirit said, "Yeah, I'm more there. My presence is more here than it is in most churches."
Yeah.
Because the church has forgotten about this place. It's forgotten. It's like we forget about the lost. We forget about Luke 15. We forget about the man and the 99 sheep and the one goes, but woman with the coins just goes for the coin. You know, the father and the son. It's like, what are we doing? It's not about you anymore. If it's still about you, it's boring, man. You're bored. I guarantee your Christian life is boring if it's about you. But when it becomes about others, when you begin to live your life, I'm not saying you can't play board games and have fun and go on vacation and do fun stuff. Don't do that stuff. But your life, the pulse, the heartbeat of your life is, gee, I just want my life to matter. You know? I'm just getting to a place, I'm like 34 years old and I want my life to matter. I'm like, it's more than, like I don't really care about church growth like you would think I do. But I just want people to know Jesus and be healed and come into that joy, you know? Hallelujah. I don't want to get to heaven. I'm closing. We got to do communion. Jesus, I don't want to get to heaven and see nobody behind me, man. I want to get to heaven and see hundreds and thousands. You know? How about you? Alright, well, we're going to do communion. We'll get that ready. Is it ready to go?
Yeah, just gotta, if you're a parent, go grab your kids, bring them in.
Oh, let's get all the kids in and we'll take communion together.